In this video from IT Free Training, I will look at how to configure the password policy for your domain. The password policy allows the administrator to configure options like how often a user password will need to be changed and how complex the password will need to be. Security is an important consideration in the modern workplace. Often security and costs do not go hand in hand, and a trade-off between security and cost will often have to be made. By the end of this video, you will not only know how to configure the password policy for your domain, but also have a good understanding of which settings to configure to give you the best results for your organization. In the domain, the password settings for the domain are configured using the default domain policy. If you want to change the password setting for the domain, it must be done here. If you configure the settings in another group policy, these settings will be ignored. Active Directory does support multiple password policies for different users, which I will cover in the next video. In this video, I will only look at configuring the default password policy options. For the present, any of the password policy settings that are configured in the default domain policy will be applied to all users in the domain. For this reason, it is considered best practice to only configure password settings in the default domain policy. For example, settings like desktop settings and software deployment should be in a separate group policy. Essentially, any settings other than password policy settings should be configured in a separate GPO. To configure these settings, open Group Policy Management from Administrative Tools under the Start menu. At the top is Default Domain Policy. This is created when the domain is created and is the only place you should consider configuring the default password settings for your domain. Once I edit the default domain policy, the password policies are found under Computer Configuration, Windows Settings, Security Settings, and Account Policies. The settings are divided into three parts: Password Policy, Account Lockout Policy, and Kerberos Policy. If I now exit out of here, I will have a closer look at the settings that are available. Under Password Policy, there are six settings. The first setting is Enforce Password History. This allows you to determine how many previous passwords will be kept before Windows will allow the user to use the same password again. This prevents the user, when asked to change their password, from simply changing the password to a password they used before. By default, this value is set to 24, and thus, a user would only be able to reuse their current password after they have changed their password 24 times. The next setting, Maximum Password Age, determines the maximum number of days a user can use a password before they are forced to change it. If the user does not change the password before this, they will be forced to change it next time they log in. If they are already logged in, they will find that they will not be able to access resources on the network. This setting can be a particular annoying one for user accounts that are always logged in or for service accounts if the password is not changed in time. If I open Active Directory Users and Computers from the Start menu, I will locate a user and then open the properties for that user. If I open the Account tab, when a user password is past the maximum password age, the tick box, User Must Change Password at Next Logon, will be ticked. If you wish to prevent a password on a user account from expiring, you will need to tick the tick box, Password Never Expires. Settings configured in here will override the settings configured at the domain level. The next setting you can configure is Minimum Password Age. This setting determines how long a user must have a password before they can change it. If you use the Enforce Password History, it is important to also set this option. By default, the user can only change their password once per day. Given that the default password history is 24, this would mean that in order for a user to reuse the same password, they would need to change their password once per day for 25 days. If this setting was not configured, a user could potentially change their password 25 times in a row to get back to their original password. Believe me, if this setting is not configured, there are users that would change their password 25 times to get back to their original password if you allowed them. The next setting, minimum password length, determines how long the password needs to be. The default is 7 characters. The next setting, password must meet complexity requirements, means that the password is checked when it is changed to ensure that it meets a number of requirements. Otherwise, it will not be changed. These requirements are that the password must be at least 6 or more characters and contain 3 of the 4 of the following: contain uppercase, lowercase, digits, and non-alphanumeric characters. Since only 3 of the 4 are requirements, you could, for example, have a password with lowercase letters, a number, and a non-alphanumeric symbol like @, and star. You could also have a password with upper and lowercase letters and a number, which would also be valid. The last requirement for the password is that it does not contain parts of the username or full name. This requirement only exists for names that are over 2 characters. If this requirement were enforced for very small usernames, like a username with only 2 characters, this would make it difficult to change the password, as many potential passwords would contain those 2 characters. By default, this setting is enabled. It should be noted that this setting only takes effect when the user attempts to change their password. If you use the admin tools to change the password, or the password is already set, the password can be a non-complex password. The last option, store password using reversible encryption, stores the password in a format that can be decrypted by applications. This is not very secure and should be avoided when possible. It should be noted here that if this option is switched on, the password will not be stored in reversible encryption until it is changed. This is because Active Directory uses a one-way function to store the password. It is not physically possible to reverse this process to obtain the password. This covers the password policy settings. The next group of settings is the account lockout policy. These settings determine what happens when a user attempts to log in and they provide the wrong password. A common form of password attack is what is referred to as a brute force attack. This is when a hacker attempts to try a number of passwords in sequence in an attempt to guess the password. For example, if a brute force attack was attempted to find out a PIN number, the brute force attack would generally start from 0 and continue upward until the PIN number is worked out. If too many attempts are tried with the same user and the wrong password in a row, Active Directory can lock the account out, requiring an administrator to unlock the account or a time period to expire before the account can be used again. If I open Active Directory users and computers and open the user properties, notice that on the account tab, there is a tick box, Unlock Account. If this tick box is ticked, the account is locked. An administrator can clear this tick box to unlock the account, or if configured to do so, will clear itself after a period of time has expired. An account can become locked if a user is attempting to log in to a computer, but it can also become locked if the user attempts to access a resource on the network and is prompted for a password and enters in an incorrect password too many times. If this were to occur, this can cause their user account to become locked. In Windows Server 2003 and above, domain controllers will check the password given with the password used before the last password change. If there is a match, the user account will not be locked. This prevents the user from being locked out due to an application or service still using the old password. Also, the built-in administrator account cannot be locked out. This is because a hacker could lock out the administrator account on purpose to prevent it from being used. If multiple authentication requests for the administrator are received in a row, Windows will start using a delay before answering authentication requests for the administrator account. This will help prevent the administrator account from being compromised from a brute force attack, as it limits how many password attempts can be tried over time. The first setting that can be configured for lockout is account lockout duration. This setting determines how long a user account, after it is locked out, will automatically be unlocked. This is a useful setting for companies that run 24 hours a day but do not have 24-hour IT support. If a user account were to be locked out during the middle of the night, the user would simply need to wait until the user account automatically unlocks itself, rather than calling the IT department in the middle of the night to have the user account unlocked. If this setting is not configured, once a user account is locked, it will remain locked until an administrator unlocks it. The next setting is account lockout threshold. This setting determines how many wrong logon attempts have to be made before a user account is locked out. By default, this value is zero, which means that the user account will never be locked out. The next setting, reset account lockout counter after, determines how many minutes need to expire before the failed logon counter is reset. For example, if the account lockout threshold were set to 5, the user could attempt to log in 5 times before the account was logged out. If the user, however, attempted to log in 4 times, this would be recorded. If reset account lockout counter was configured to 10 minutes, the user would need to wait 10 minutes before the failed counter would be reset. After 10 minutes, they would be able to attempt to log in again up to 5 times. If you decide to configure reset account lockout counter after and account lockout threshold together, you must also configure account lockout duration to the same value or greater. This covers account lockout. The last section is Kerberos policy. On most networks, you will leave these settings on the default and will never need to change them as the defaults work quite well. It is unlikely that Microsoft will ask you a question on the exam about these settings, so I will go through them only to help your understanding of how Kerberos works. The first option, Enforce User Logon Restriction, will check if the user has the required rights before granting a Kerberos ticket. For example, if a user was attempting to access a computer from remote, they would need the Access This Computer from the Network right. If they did not have this right, creating the ticket would be a waste of time, as they would be denied access anyway. By default, this setting is enabled. On a slow network, it may be worth considering switching this option off due to the delay of the server having to travel the network to check the local policy before creating the ticket. On modern networks, this should not be an issue. The next two settings, Maximum Lifetime for Service Ticket and Maximum Lifetime for a User Ticket, determine how long a Kerberos ticket can be used. The default is 10 hours. After the ticket expires, it will need to be renewed or a new one created. The next setting, Maximum Lifetime for User Ticket Renewal, determines how long a user ticket can be renewed until it has to be recreated. The default is 7 days. The last setting is Maximum Tolerance for Computer Clock Synchronization. Kerberos puts a timestamp in the tickets that it creates. A timestamp helps prevent replay attacks. A replay attack is when data is captured by a third party and then resent to a server at a later date. The hope is the server will think the data is from the original user and allow it. To prevent this, timestamps are used so the data cannot be used later on. To allow a system like this to occur, the time on the client and the domain controllers must be in sync. By default, Kerberos allows a time difference of up to 5 minutes. The settings I have looked at here, I would recommend leaving on the default rather than changing them. For example, if you are having problems with clock synchronization, I would look at ways to keep your time on your computers in sync rather than change the settings in here. The last thing to consider when modifying the security policy is which settings to configure. Before you change anything, check the security policy on your computer. A lot of companies have requirements that they use, for example, how long a user password needs to be. Also, a large enough company will have auditors come in who will check security settings on the network. You should make sure that your settings meet the minimum requirements for the auditors. Otherwise, this can be an embarrassing configuration setting for an auditor to find and report to your employer. Next, perform a cost versus security comparison. There are many different ideas about what security settings should be set to. Configuring the password settings so that users are forced to use longer passwords is considered better security, but may cost you more in support calls for password resets. Also, consider the real security value of the settings you choose. There have been a number of studies done that have found that forcing the users to change their password too often results in poor security. This is because it is more likely that the user will write their passwords down. Users will also tend to put a number at the end of their password and change the number each time the password needs to change. For example, the password will end with the number of the current month. Extra password changes also generally create more calls to the help desk for password resets. Thanks for watching this video on password policy for Active Directory. Traditionally, only one password policy can be configured per domain, and this is stored in the default domain policy. In the next video, I will look at how multiple password policies can be configured in the single domain, allowing you to tailor password settings to particular users. For more free videos in this course and others, please visit our YouTube channel or subscribe. See you in the next video.